Good morning and welcome to Martinsburg Grace Brethren Church. It's just awesome to be able to worship with all of you. Great to see all of you this morning, and also those of you that are watching online. We are here this morning to worship our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and so we want to welcome all of you here this morning. Just to remember, next week we go back to our adult Bible fellowship classes, Sunday school classes, starting at 9 o'clock next Sunday, followed by 10:15 worship. If you're not involved in an adult Bible fellowship class, next Sunday would be a great opportunity for you to come. And one of those classes is being offered by Pastor Rudy down in the fellowship hall. It's a series on family worship, developing and forming and carrying out family worship in your own home. And he's going to do a six-week study there. And all of you are welcome. Also, those sessions will be video recorded and be put on our website so that you can go to the website and watch those if you are unable to attend. But just keep in mind, next Sunday we will go back to our traditional Sunday school adult Bible fellowship time at 9 a.m. Men's retreat is right around the corner, September 8th and 9th. Registration deadline is next Sunday. Men's retreat, Camp Manawagon, registration deadline is next Sunday. If you have any questions about that, see me, Pastor Brandt, Pastor Rudy. There's information at the information desk, as well as the women's retreat, which is coming up on September 22nd, 3rd, and the 24th. There are information brochures at the information desk out there. Feel free to grab one of those. Pastor Brandt, you have some announcements.
Yes, and speaking of retreats, we have another retreat. That's for the young adults on October 6th and 7th. I will have the registration information out this week. The theme is recharge. So if you're a young adult and you need to just have a time to recharge and hang out with other adults your age, join us at camp on October 6th and 7th. We're really looking forward to the time. Pastor Mark Lingenfelder from Lamersville will have a session. I'll be speaking as well. And so we'll just have a good time also of interaction and sharing together. The Israel trip that I'm planning to host next May from the 4th through the 15th of 2024 is just about full. And I am just shocked that we have 52 people signed up out of 53. We have one spot left for a lady. It would be really helpful to have one more lady go. So this is your challenge. If you were thinking about going to Israel, it's time to sign up. And we may offer another trip in a couple years just because of the overwhelming interest in that. I also wanted to just make this mention, too, that we received word on Thursday that Pastor Bill Snell, who pastored our church from 1968 to 1990 here and had just wonderful vision for children and youth ministry. He really was instrumental in helping us hire our first youth pastor in 1978 here at the church. So one of the reasons why our church really focuses on children and youth is because of the Snells. And Pastor Snell is now with his wife Jeannie in heaven. He was 91 years old, and the funeral will be held in Ohio on September the 2nd, just to let you all know, for us who are older and remember Pastor Snell. And now Pastor Ryan has an announcement.
Can I borrow your card? Because I lost mine. Thank you. Synergy Youth resumes. Yes. Sorry, I'm really bad at announcements. Synergy, we're going to kick back off this Wednesday night. We had a great turnout, a great time at our back-to-school party this past Wednesday. This upcoming Wednesday, we'll meet in the multi-purpose room at 7 o'clock. And parents, just a heads up, we would love to spend a couple minutes after 8 o'clock just to give the kids some time to interact. A lot of times, a lot of our kids sneak in late. They slip out the door as soon as we're done. So parents, if you're in a hurry and need to grab your kids at 8 o'clock, get your kids and go ahead. If you can give them 10 minutes to interact, we're going to ask that we have those 10 minutes. If you have younger kids, that doesn't start till the following week. So we have 1 week of youth group before the elementary kids begin. Also, we are taking a trip to Uprise Festival. We had enough interest to do that. We have a bus reserved, so we would love to fill that bus. So teens, if you'd like to go with us to Uprise, you can sign up online now. The cost, I believe, is $75. And you can use your scholarship funds for that if you'd like. Need to call to the church office if you want to do that.
That's good. We're ready to stand and worship.
All right.
Here, all right. Lead us in worship, Ryan. Please stand and join us in worship.
Thank you. into the night, wanting a place to hide this weary soul. This bag of bones, I try with all my might, but I just can't win the fight. I'm slowly drifting, a vagabond. And just when I ran out of road, I met a man I didn't know, and he told me that I was not alone.
You picked me up, you turned me around, you placed my feet on solid ground. I thank Master, I thank Savior, because you healed my heart, you changed my name.
I thank
Savior, I thank God.
I cannot deny what I've seen. Got no choice but to believe. My doubts are burning like ashes in the wind. So long to my old friends. Burden and bitterness, you just keep it moving. Now you ain't welcome here. From now till I walk the streets of gold, I'll sing of how you saved my soul. This wayward son has found his way back. Savior, because you healed my heart, you changed my name, forever free, I'm not the same. I thank the Master, I thank the Savior, I thank God. Lost another one, I am free, I am free, I am free. Yeah, lost another one, I am free, I am free, I am free. Yeah, lost another one, I am free, I am free, I am free.
Amen. Let's meet and greet each other. If you see someone you don't recognize, make sure to introduce yourself.
Thank you, Tim. I think we'll stay. It's just a quick announcement.
I don't know the motion.
That's fine.
Yeah. Oh, he was?
Yeah.
I like it. Yeah, thank you.
Hey, Mr. Dell. All right, all right, all right. I just want to take a few minutes this morning just to highlight a ministry. It's nothing new. It's been around at our church. Maybe it's something that you were aware of. Maybe you aren't aware of it, or maybe you're even involved in it. But it's life groups. Our church has been having life groups for years, and part of my role here at MGBC is to foster, care, and equip the life groups within our church. In 1 Thessalonians 2, verse 8, Paul said to the Thessalonian church, he said, I have such a fond affection for you that it was not only good for me to share the gospel with you, but also my entire life. And so within Scripture, we see that believers have the opportunity not just to share truth with one another, but to share life together. And that's what the purpose of our life groups are. Life groups are groups of people within the body of MGBC who get together in order to do four things. And each life group looks different in size, in age, in study, in times that they meet. But really, I see four core values across the board. And one of those values is building. We build relationships with one another in order to stir one another on to love and good deeds. We encourage one another. And that word encourage in the Bible is more than just you've got it, but it is to strengthen one another. And the way that we do that is praying together, is counseling one another with biblical wisdom. It's serving one another. A third word is disciple. In each of our groups, we desire to grow in discipleship, in being a learning follower of Jesus Christ. And each of our pastors each week, we give you questions to go deeper and to go further in what we're studying together as a body. And your life group has those questions so that you can talk and learn from one another. And that the fourth thing is challenging one another. Just like Hebrews 10 says, we challenge one another. We stir one another on to love and good deeds, and also to hold fast to this truth of who God is and what he's done for us. But we also challenge one another to reach out to those who are apart from Christ and who do not yet know Christ. And so life groups are an opportunity for this to happen. And if you're interested in life groups, Aaron did a fantastic job of updating our website this week. There's a page that you can go to at mgbconline.com, and you can find out more of what I've been talking about this morning. But there's an interest button. There's, if you have a desire to lead a life group, there's a button for that. Or also, if you just want to know what our life groups are working through with questions based on the sermon, there's a button for that as well. Or you could talk to myself. But we'd love to get you plugged into a life group so that this just goes beyond 1 hour, one day a week. But this could be a great, great encouragement in your life as you follow Jesus Christ. All right, Pastor Brian.
We'll tell you that about a year ago, went through a health situation, and my life group was instrumental in Shelly and I in going through that. We're doing life together, encouraging one another, strengthening one another. So I would just really encourage you to consider and pray through your involvement, potential involvement in life groups. Gentlemen, if you would come forward this time, we're going to worship our Lord and Savior through our tithes and offerings. As we go and prayer, I want to just bring before you Roscoe and Dorothy Caruder. Many of you know that their son, Steve Caruder, passed away this past week, as well as Mitch and Sherry Steele in the passing of Mitch's mom, Jane Steele. She passed away this week also. And there are also many, many on our prayer sheet, on our prayer list that comes out each week dealing with health situations. So we want to lift them up. Finally, also just I'm going to pray briefly this morning for our friends in Haiti. As many of you know, there's a lot of turmoil going on down there. We have definite connections and have assisted down there. We have a school down there, and it is getting very, very difficult for the people. It's a continued difficult situation, so we're going to pray for them this morning. Join me, if you would. Father God, we thank you and praise you for how you are keenly aware and involved in all of the things that go on within our world and in our individual lives. We pray for Roscoe and for Dorothy, for Danielle, for the family in the passing this week of Steve as he has come home to be with you. Father, we thank you and praise you for that. For the Steele family in the passing of Jane, we just ask that you would provide a peace there, Father. Also, just draw near to them so that your Holy Spirit can provide the comfort that they so desperately need, Lord. We pray for the people of Haiti in that situation down there, for the violence, for the disruption, for the chaos. Lord, you know all things, and you are in all things and moving through all things, Father. So we just ask that you would protect those people down there, protect the innocent, be with those that we have made connections with. Many in this congregation sitting here this morning know people that are currently living through difficult situations in Haiti, and Leanne Koo and Burrell and Port-au-Prince and Cape Haitien and all of the various locations. Father, we just ask that you would move with power and strength there. Lord, we worship you this morning in giving back what you have graciously given to us. We thank you and praise you for the blessings that you have provided. In thy name we pray. Amen.
I'd love to tag on what Pastor Rudy and Pastor Brian just shared. Laura and I have been part of a life group for the past 4 years. A little over a week ago, we met. We discussed Pastor Brian's previous message from 2 weeks ago, and he had this reflection question: whom do I thank when things go well? Whom do I thank when things go well? We just sang the right answer, the Sunday school answer, God, Jesus, I thank God. That's the right answer. It should be that. I guess the conversation may have gone to, I guess I thank myself sometimes, but I think when I was more honest in the discussion, we had a great discussion about it, I thought, often I just thank nobody. And I think that's just as bad as misdirecting it on myself or onto somebody else when it's supposed to be to God. I just thank nobody. I think, well, yeah, that's how things were supposed to go. That's how it's supposed to happen. I'm going to move on with my life. So having that conversation amongst those friends that we've gotten really close with was helpful in helping me to refocus where my thanks should be focused on towards God. So anytime believers come together, we have the opportunity to encourage one another. We did it last week at Camp Manawagon. We did that through baptisms, through fellowship, just spending time together. It's something we get to do every single Sunday morning when we sing together. We get to sing our prayers. We get to sing our prayers together. Worship music, for me, and I think for a lot of you because you've shared it with me, worship music often helps me put into words what I'm already feeling and I just can't get it out. So when we sing together, we get to put our prayers to a melody, and we get to pray it together. We get to declare truth from God's word. And in the Gospels of Matthew and Luke, Jesus teaches us how to pray. He gives us a model to follow, a reminder that the kingdom, the power, the glory are all God's. So we've been singing this song a good bit. We're going to sing it again this morning. Please stand as we sing the Lord's Prayer, that we sing this model prayer that Jesus gave to us. Please sing with us.
Father, let your kingdom come. Father, let your will be done. On earth as in heaven, right here in my heart. Father, let your kingdom come. Father, let your will be done. On earth as in heaven, right here in my heart. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us, forgive us. As we forgive the ones who sinned against us, forgive them. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. Let your kingdom come.
Father, let your kingdom come. Father, let your will be done. On earth as in heaven. Your kingdom come. Father, let your will be done. On earth as in heaven, right here in my heart.
Give us this day our daily bread.
forgive us as we forgive the ones who sinned against us. Forgive them and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. Let your kingdom come. It's yours, it's yours, all yours, all yours. The kingdom, the power, the glory are yours. It's yours, it's yours, all yours, all yours. Forever and ever, the kingdom is yours. It's yours, it's yours, all yours, all yours. The kingdom, the power, the glory are yours. It's yours, it's yours, all yours, all yours. Forever and ever, the kingdom is yours. Father, let your kingdom come. Father, let your will be done. On earth as in heaven, right here in my heart. Father, let your kingdom come. Father, let your will be done. On earth as in heaven, right here in my heart. On earth as in heaven, right here in my heart. But don't have love, I waste my breath with every song I break. An empty voice, a hollow noise. And if I speak with a silver tongue, convince a crowd, but don't have love, I leave a bitter taste with every word I say. So let my life be the proof of your what you're made of. How you live, how you die, love and sacrifice. So let my life be the proof of your love.
If I give to a needy soul but don't have love, then who poor and seems all the poverty is found in me.
So let my life be the proof of your love. Let my love look like you and what you're made of. How you live, how you die, love and sacrifice. So let my life be the proof of your love.
The proof of your love.
Let my love look like you and what you're made of. How you live, how you die, love and sacrifice. So let my life be the proof of your love.
darkness, I put idols on your throne. But you met me by my will. Now I thirst for you alone. Oh God, you are my God. And I will search for you. In this dry and weary land, my soul longs to thirst for you. In the wilderness I wandered, growing weary, growing weak. All the pathways that I traveled focused selfishly on me. Was a sinner lost in darkness, I put idols on your throne. But you met me by my will, now I thirst for you alone.
Steadfast love is better than life. My lips will praise, my soul satisfied.
Steadfast love,
steadfast love is better than life.
It's better than life.
My lips will praise,
my lips will praise.
My soul satisfied.
My soul satisfied.
Steadfast love. It's better than life. My lips will praise. My soul satisfied. Your steadfast love is better than life. My lips will praise. My soul satisfied.
Come before you this morning. You are God, Lord, and we lift up your name and worship you, that you are creator, you are sustainer, you are the one who has rescued us through your son, Jesus. And Lord, it is our desire to know your will this morning, and not just to know it, but to live within it. I pray that you would be glorified in all that is done through the rest of this service, and I pray this in Jesus' name. All right, kids are dismissed. Preschool out that way, elementary that way. This morning we're going to be moving to a new sub-series in our study through the letter of 1 Corinthians concerning Christ and his church. And if you haven't grabbed one yet, there's series reading booklets in the lobby right by the glass doors there. Make sure you get one before you leave. There's a page for sermon notes in there. There's a page for sermon reflection and application, and then even reading throughout the week so that you could study right along with us as we work through this letter. But all of that reading guide is really for the purpose that you would grow as Paul prayed for the Colossians in spiritual wisdom and understanding. But as you can see this morning in the nice purpley font, the new series is on gifts. Gifts given to the church. And these are gifts given for the establishment and the foundation of the church, but also for the building up of the body of Christ, that we would look more and more like Jesus, and that we would live more and more in a way that honors him and brings glory to his name. But also through this study, we're going to look at God's order for the church and the worship that he desires within the church. In our last passage, Pastor Brian shared Paul's words in 1 Corinthians 10:31, where Paul says, "So then, whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, do all to the glory of God." That verse, those words, are why you and I were created, to lift up and to show off who our Creator God is. And we should all live in such a way that our lives demonstrate the worth of who God is, but also declares the wonder of what God has done for us through his Son, Jesus. And so in Romans 12:1, Paul tells us that worship begins in surrendering to that. Surrendering to that truth that you are here to bring glory to the Lord. And God has given us commandment in his word in order to do that. But he's not only given us commandment, but he's also given us very specific instruction in how to bring glory to him. And so Paul explains in Romans 12:1, well, the way that we worship then is to surrender to that commandment, to surrender to that will, to surrender to that instruction. It's by giving ourselves to the Lord and by changing our minds from what is the course and the pattern of this world to what is good and acceptable and perfect in the Word of God. Now, with that said, I want you to imagine this morning that Jesus visited you. Just like Jesus did to Solomon in a dream, Jesus comes to visit you. And he says to you, "Hey, I love you so much. I love you so much. I remember the day that I created you. I remember the day that I died for you. I remember the moment that I saved you. And because I love you so much, I've made you with intention. And I've made you with design. There's purpose for why you are here. And there's a position that I've made you for." Now listen, if you would take this place, if you would grab hold of this position that I have for you, then I know that you would be an awesome display of me in this world. And that when people look at you, they will see not only who I am, but what I've done for you. Now, what do you think? What do you think? Would you take this role that he's offering to you? Would you present yourself, as Paul calls us to in Romans 12, as a living sacrifice to the Lord, saying, "Well, here I am, Lord. Use me in this way that you have for me." How would you respond? Would you check to see what kind of positions other people had? Well, what's he get to do? Or what's she get to do? And what if theirs was different? Would you begin to question then the so-called love that God had for you, or this worth and this value that he's talking about? Would you take time then to figure out, well, is this position really necessary in our world today? Or does it really apply to my setting that I'm in? And what if someone else gets to do what you want to do? Or what if you would be better at what they're doing? Would you fight the Lord until you got your way? Or would you just pass it off completely and just do what you want anyways? Or you could respond in laziness. "Oh yeah, that's what I should do." But then do nothing. Or out of selfish ambition, hear this position that God has for you and say, okay, I can use this. I can get something out of this. What if you didn't feel like doing what Jesus wanted you to do? Or what if this world around you had a seemingly better role for you? And the reason I ask all these questions is because this is what our Lord does through this passage in 1 Corinthians 11. He comes to each of us as men and as women with a God-ordained and God-designed role that he has intentionally created us for. Yet these are the responses of so many. So many, not just out there, but if we're honest, in here. So many responses that people have and can and do have towards the Lord concerning these positions. But as I said, we were created. We're not only created, but we're commanded. We're not only commanded, but we're saved to bring glory to the Lord. As Paul wrote to the Colossians in Colossians 1, verse 16, you were made for him. As he wrote to the Corinthians in 2 Corinthians 5, 15, you were saved for him. As he wrote in Romans 14, verse 7, if we live, we live for him. And so some examining questions that we're all going to have to deal with now and towards the end of this passage are things like, is my life for him? Is it for him or is it for me? Because Scripture says clearly, right, it's for him. But how do you respond to that? Am I receiving what the Lord Jesus, my God and Savior, who I sing to each and every Sunday morning, and I lift up his name, am I receiving what the Lord Jesus, my God and Savior, has for me because my life is for him? Or am I in some way, by my attitudes, by my actions, fighting against this? Will I surrender myself in worship, as Paul says in Romans 12, 1, to his will and to his design for me, or instead be conformed to this world? Or just succumb to my feelings and whether I feel like it or not? The following passage, 1 Corinthians 11, it's been labeled controversial. It could be volatile in our current climate. There are those who just pass it off as confusing, and somehow Pastor Rudy was put on the list for this morning. I don't know how that schedule worked out, but but we're going to see, you know, with all those labels, with all that talk, Paul's aim here is actually just to clear up confusion amongst believers, which makes this incredibly practical for our day today. It's no secret that we live in incredibly confusing times. Especially when it comes to gender, or when it comes to marriage, or when it comes to the church. And it's good for us to stop and to remember that our God, 1 Corinthians 14, verse 33, our God is not a God of confusion. There is truth to the old hymn that sings, 'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take him at his word, just to rest upon his promise, just to know, thus saith the Lord. God's not a God of confusion, but he's a God of peace. And where do we find that peace? Well, we find that peace in his word. It's in the mindset that if my life is for him, and this is what he has for me, well, then by his spirit and by his strength at work within me, then this is how I will live. This is what I will surrender to in worship to him. All right, in verse 1 of 1 Corinthians 11, Paul concludes his previous section and teaching. He's answered questions pertaining to caring for one another with our liberty that we have in Christ. And to summarize what we worked through in those chapters, we're to use our liberty in such a way that it would not hinder the gospel from going forth, that it would not be a stumbling block to cause a brother or sister into sin, but also that it would not be an obstacle preventing somebody else from seeing and knowing Jesus, his will, and his work. And so rather than liberty being something that we latch onto as believers, it is something that we are ready and willing to lay down for the glory of the Lord. Our pursuit is that God would be glorified in all that we do. And so the way that happens is to be like Jesus. And so Paul says in verse 1, be imitators of me as I am of Christ. Who do we look to for this way of life, of surrender, of laying ourselves down for the good of others? Well, we look to the Lord. Our pursuit is Jesus. And Paul says, hey, at the end of it all, I just want to be like Jesus. And I just want that for you as well. And so follow me, imitate me as I follow and imitate the Lord Jesus. This is what Paul wants for him, what he invites the Corinthians to join him in. And family, when we think about it, what did Paul write to the Philippians? Paul said, to live, to really live, is what? Pursue your dreams. To live, to really live, is to be the best version of you that you could be. To live, to really live, is what? Is Christ. Is Christ. And so if Jesus is not our pursuit in this life, then, by biblical definition, we're not living. We're wasting our time. We fall short of not only what that biblical definition for life is, but also we fall short of the glory of God. And so in verse 2, then, Paul begins this new section that's going to carry over through chapter 14. And as I said, he wants to address matters of church worship and assembly along with gifts given to the church. And the first thing Paul says, he writes, now I commend you because you remember me in everything and maintain the traditions even as I delivered them to you. Now, what's Paul commending them for? Well, one, he's commending them for coming to him with their questions. He says, because you remember me in everything. At this point, even with all the trouble within the church, even with all the questions and the confusion, they remember, we could go to Paul with this. They remember that Paul has authority as an apostle and that he has God's truth to speak into their situation at Corinth in order to clear up confusion there. And Paul sees that's a good thing. That's a grace of the Lord, and he commends them for that. The Corinthians recognize where the truth was going to come from. And now with that, I wonder if Paul could commend us for the same thing. In question, in confusion, in uncertainty, are we quick to run to the sure and tested Word of God, or is it, hey Siri, or Alexa, can you tell me what, or Google, or I wonder if something's on my news feed about this? Or maybe there's a podcast that I can check out. Or there has to be a YouTube video on this. Now, Charles Spurgeon said of the Bible, these words come from him. They come from him who can make no mistake and who can have no wish to deceive his creatures. Yet, so often as his creatures, with our questions, with our concerns for counsel, for direction, for guidance, we turn otherwise. But Paul also commends them for maintaining the traditions even as I delivered them to you. This word traditions is not only a fantastic restaurant, but it also in second comes up in 2 Thessalonians 2:15 as well. There, Paul had to encourage the Thessalonians. He says, so then, brothers, stand firm and hold to the tradition. So they weren't doing what the Corinthians were doing. And so Paul has to stir them up. He has to challenge them and strengthen them that they would hold to the traditions that were taught by us, either by spoken word or by our letter. And so this word, traditions, it literally means that which has been passed down. And Paul answers what has been passed down to us in 2 Thessalonians 2:15. What did the apostles pass down to those that they taught? What did they pass down through their preaching and through their teaching? Well, they passed down the word of God. The traditions is God's revealed will for us to hold to and for us to live by. And now the Corinthians were on track with that first part. They were holding to what was true. They could tell you what was true about God and about his world and about what he's done. But it was that second part of living by it, of applying it, where they were having a lot of trouble. Now there's misunderstanding here, which is why Paul follows up in verse 3. He says, but I want you to understand. And I stop here because he is calling for their attention and for their focus. Their focus off of everything else around him. This is like a father or a coach saying, hey, heads up, okay? Eyes on me. Okay, I didn't say look at them. I don't care what they're doing, but you look at me. Are you listening to me? I want to see the pupils. I want to see the darkness in your eyes. Look at me. I want you to understand this. And you see, part of the reason for so much confusion around genders, around roles, around the relationship between men and women in homes or in the church is really because we're too busy looking and getting our information from everywhere else, where Paul says, hey, I want you to understand this. Look at me. Look here. Look into this word. And Paul writes, I want you to understand what? He says that the head of every man is Christ, the head of a wife is her husband, and the head of Christ is God. Now, I want to make a note. The ESV is the only version that translates that middle part, the head of a wife is her husband. I lined up translations side by side, NASB, NIV, KJV, HCSB, all translate that, and the man is the head of a woman. Now, the ESV admits in their footnotes that the Greek word, it could mean either wife or woman, but I think they make a commentary decision by making this translation to be wife. Now, I don't disagree with that. Paul does mean wife, and this is absolutely true in the home. But I also believe that based on the context that Paul is speaking, he's not just speaking to the home here, like in Ephesians 5, but he is speaking into the relationships in the church and in public worship as well. And so I'm going to side with the majority here to read this woman, man, rather than wife, husband. And I'm going to have it on the slides as that, just so that you're not wondering what translation I'm using. I'm using ESV, but I'm using the more accepted translation for those words. But this verse, it leads to our first point this morning. What does Paul want us to understand? He wants us to understand there is distinction in our roles. And what Paul does is he essentially lays out a chain of responsibility, showing us that there are roles in relationships both in heaven and on earth. And so when we sing, Father, let your will be done on earth as it is in heaven, right here in my heart. Well, this is what is in heaven and what God desires for on this earth. There's the position of a head, or the role of authority, and there's the position of submission. And so what does this chain look like? Well, Paul lays it out in verse 3, but if we wrote it out, it is God, Christ, man, woman. Now, what is Paul not saying here? And I think that's vitally important to hear what he's not saying. Well, one, he is not saying that man is superior to woman or that woman is inferior. For him to be saying that would be to say the same thing about Christ and about God. He's very, very careful, and he does this strategically by the Holy Spirit in how he lays that out, that this is not a question of superiority or inferiority. He's not saying that man is more capable than woman is not capable. Again, to be saying that about man and woman would be to be saying that about Christ and about God. There's also no thought process here that men and women are not equal as persons. Paul himself wrote in Galatians 3, verse 28, that we are all one in Christ. And I find it amazing that so many want to fight for the equality of women when that's not even a question in Scripture. We are equal before God. We're created in His image, right? In Genesis 1, we see that. We are equal in Christ. We are co-heirs with Christ in salvation. We have the same access to the Father's throne. And again, to say otherwise, that we are not equal, would be to say that the Son is not equal to the Father. But why we're here is to see what Paul is saying. He is saying that even in the relationship in heaven between the Father and the Son, there is distinction in our roles and responsibilities. Where do we see that? And how do we see that in the relationship with the Father and the Son? Well, in love, the Son submits to the authority of the Father. And we see that most beautifully and most clearly in the redemption story. The Father sent His Son. The Son, fully God, with every right of godness in heaven. He is equal in person, He is equal in power, and He says in John 6:38, I've come down from heaven not to do my own will, but the will of Him who has sent me. He submitted. In every command of the law, although He is the perfectly righteous and holy one, He's the one who brought forth the law, yet He submitted Himself under the law. In the garden, when He is sweating drops of blood and He is going over what He is about to do, He submitted with the words, "Not my will, but yours be done." On the cross, when He's under the fierce wrath of God for our sin, He submits. Now, does this make Him less than God? No. He and the Father are one. Does this render Him without honor? No, to Christ is given the name that is above every other name. He is the exact representation of the Father, yet He submitted in all things, whether eating or drinking, to the glory of God. And so that's what that looks like between the Father and the Son, God and Christ. What does this mean for women, especially what does it mean for men, especially for husbands? Well, first and foremost, if you could see, your role begins with your submission to Jesus Christ. Paul writes clearly here, the head of every man is Christ. Now, this is true of every man in and out of this room, whether you have surrendered to Jesus Christ and given your life to Him or not. Christ is your head. He is over you as Lord and as King of Kings. There is coming a day when every knee will bow before Him. That is, either in willing, joyful, love and submission to him as king, or they will bend forcefully under the weight of his glory and under the majesty of who he is. Jesus is Lord. He is king. And it is the standard, it's the responsibility of every man, whether you could give 2 cents or any care to what I'm saying. It is the standard and responsibility of every man to hold to this truth and to live in light of the fact that Jesus is Lord. And what did Christ's submission to the Father mean? Well, it meant carrying out the Father's will and desire in this world. Christ is who we are accountable to, and just as Christ represented his Father in this world, as men, we are called to represent Christ in this world. And so the man, yes, is given authority over the woman, but what is that authority for? And we've talked about this before. He is to be Christ. That is what your authority for. It is to be Jesus in the home, in the workplace, in everywhere else in this world. You lead. Your leadership means serving your family as Jesus. In the home, you're given authority to lay down your life for those under you. In the church, pastors and elders, they're given authority to serve and to protect the church and to feed the flock of the Lord, but they're also given their authority to lay down their lives. They should shepherd in such a way that they point the flock to the great shepherd of their souls. This is what we're here for, men. Not to be served, but to serve. It is to be Christ, to lead, to serve, to protect, to care as Christ. And so whatever it takes to reflect him to your wife and your kids, you do that. Those who aren't married, whatever it takes for you to reflect him in this world, young ones who are still at home or old ones who are still at home, that means whatever it takes for you to reflect him to your parents, to your brothers, your sisters, you are here to reflect Jesus. Whatever that takes, you pursue that. Guys, with your friends, with those around you, men in the workplace, whatever it takes for you to reflect Jesus, that is your mission, your calling in life. But this will not happen. No, you won't do that. You can't do that if you're not first submitted to him. And I've seen far too often that if this relationship is not right, if you are not submitting to Christ, then that relationship will not be right either between men and women. And so what does this role mean for women? It means submission. Submission to your husband. We know that from Ephesians chapter 5. Ephesians 5 verse 22, Paul explains, wives, submit to your own husbands as to the Lord, and ultimately this role is about serving the Lord. As men are to be submissive to Christ in practicing authority, so women are to be submissive to Christ in practicing submission. In receiving and in obediently carrying out this position, you do that. In verse 24 of Ephesians 5, Paul continues, "Now, as the church submits to Christ, so also wives should submit in everything to their husbands." And then when we jump down to verse 33, "And let the wife see that she respects her husband." Submit as the church does to Christ. That's Paul's teaching there. And so we look to trust his leadership. As a church, we look to depend on Christ's strength. We look to respect his will, even in hard things. And this is what is true in the home as well. Knowing full well that as you do this, this is the same example that Christ gave and laid out for you in his own submission to the Father. And so when it comes down to it, to be in the position of submission is ultimately to be Jesus. So I can say the same thing to you. Whatever it takes to show your husband Jesus, you do that. Whatever it takes to show your children Jesus, you do that. Whatever it takes to show those women around you Jesus, you do that. Within God's church, this means surrendering to His design for the spiritual oversight, for the shepherding, for the preaching. And again, this is not an issue of capability. It's not an issue of intellect. It's not an issue of worth or of spirituality, but only of God's will and His glory. As men and women, we have God-given distinction in our roles and in our function in the home and in the church. Now, I want you to see here that this is not based on culture. Look at verses 7 and 9. Here Paul writes, "For man ought not to cover his head, since he is the image and glory of God, but woman is the glory of man. For man was not made from woman, but woman from man. Neither was man created for woman, but woman for man." When Paul says man is the image and glory of God, that should take us back to Genesis chapter 1, specifically verse 27. And there, in that beginning, in chapters 1 and 2, we see authority, submission, marriage, male and female, gender and distinction. These are not constructs of the great oppressors of old. These are not products of man-made institutions or cultural norms. This was put in place by God at creation. God created man to be a reflection of Himself on this earth. He was created to show God off in His rule and in His dominion over the earth. Man came first, and he was given this authority over creation, but then God saw that it was not good for man to be alone, and so He made woman, yes, in His own image, to be a reflection of Himself and to be a helper to man. And woman was made to rule under and with man's authority. And when I think about this, there's this old saying that says, behind every great man is a great woman. But God put forth at creation that beside every great man, there is a great woman helping, submitting, carrying out His leadership on this earth. And Paul writes here, the woman is the glory of man. Now, that doesn't take away from the fact that women are created in God's image, but women are also a reflection of male authority and leadership. Now, just think about that for a moment. Women are a reflection of male authority and leadership. And what did we learn at the fall? What have we learned throughout history? That sadly, this is for better or for worse. Eve's sin was a reflection of Adam's failed leadership. Eve's sin was a reflection of his lack of submission to God. And so it goes back to that chain. If we as men are not submitting to the Lord and carrying out His will in this on this earth, then it's a mess. And just as a safeguard and protection, if anyone wants to abuse these positions or take this beyond the parameters that God has given, Paul writes in verses 11 and 12, he says, "Nevertheless, in the Lord, woman is not independent of man, nor man of woman. For as woman was made from man, so man is now born of woman, and all things are from God." What is he saying? We need one another. I heard one pastor say, sons, try arguing with your mom that man came first. That argument's not going to go very far, and it's not going to go very well. Sons need godly mothers. Sons need godly mothers and grandmothers who instill in them the truth of God's word and who prepare them and who equip them to know what it means to be a man in this world and to lead in this world. And daughters need godly men. Men who will raise them up as David desired his daughters to be pillars in this world, to be unmovable and unshakable, grounded in the truth of God, especially in this world of lies. And wives, men need help. Amen? And men, that doesn't mean that your spiritual life depends on your wife. or that it depends on the women around you. It is not up to them. Your wives, your children, your family, your workplace, more than anything else, it doesn't need your financial provision or your work ethic. More than anything else, they need you to be Jesus. And when it comes to the church, you need only to look to Titus chapter 2 to see the immense value of men and women both ministering within the church. And this was shocking. It was remarkable for Paul to be writing in a time when women were viewed as nothing more than property, nothing more than slaves, nothing more than objects. It is Christianity that brings forth this standard of God that we are equal before him. Now, I've said all that, and I know the entire time that I've been working through that and pouring out my heart to you on those truths, the only thing that you've been thinking is, well, what about these head coverings? I heard something about that in that verse, and even my heading here in the Bible says head coverings. Yeah, submission, authority, okay, we got all that. Do I need to wear a hat next week or not? When I preached on this text before, I did it in 3 Sundays, and so I've got more notes than what I have for you, and I'm going to try to get you out of here faster than 3 days from now. So we're going to move quickly through point number 2. We've got the main principle, and I think that's important that through all this, there is a main thing here. And that's a teaching in preaching and Bible study that we got to keep the main thing the main thing. The main thing here is that there is distinction in our roles. There's God ordained and God designed to us as men and as women. And that goes back to creation. And so if this is true, well then Paul argues that there should also be, point number 2, distinction in our representation. If you were created male or if you were created female, then there's a way to receive that from the Lord and to represent that in this world as your spiritual act of worship to him. Now, before we get into this, history shows us that in the Corinthian society, there was a standard of dress, and that was already in place, and this distinguished men and women from one another. Veils were already worn or they were not worn by women in Greek and Roman society. And so in this passage, Paul's not introducing anything new to them. He's not introducing anything completely foreign to them. He's merely modifying what they were used to so that they would remember and reflect the main thing, the principle, but at the same time that they would represent this principle and represent their God-given gender. And so verse 4, Paul says, every man who prays or prophesies with his head covered dishonors his head. Paul's saying to these men, if you are wearing something on your head, you bring a disgrace upon your head. And I take that head to mean both your own head, yourself, but also your spiritual head, Christ. Now, there would be a few reasons for why a man would have his head covered in this society. One, what is something that you know about Orthodox Jewish men? They have head coverings. They wear one. You can't go to the Wailing Wall and pray there today without your head covered as a man. And Paul here is leading them to remove that. And he's leading them to remove that, one, because that's based on a misunderstanding of Exodus 33, but two, them having their head coverings is sending the wrong message in the Corinthian society and culture. Another group of men that would have had their head coverings are pagan priests. The pagan priests of Corinth, they would have also had their heads covered in sacred ceremonies. And Paul, this whole time, has been leading them away from associating themselves with that pagan worship and with idolatry and separating themselves from the world. But third, in Greco-Roman societies, there were hats that were worn as a sign of freedom. If you were freed out of slavery as a Roman citizen, then you were given what was called a pileus to proudly don, and this was your symbol of freedom to those around you. And so to have this hat on says, I am free, I am a Roman. And so do you see how this teaching, it would have been a lot harder for the men to take in rather than the women. Because one, Jewish men are saying, we were wrong. Two, pagan priests are saying, we were wrong and we're coming out of that. And three, the Greco-Roman men who are wearing those hats would be saying, what? I'm a slave. But when I think about that, what an awesome way to come before the Lord, and that is the way we're called to come before the Lord Jesus Christ, before his throne, saying, I was wrong, you have taken me from my old way of life, and now I am a slave to you. But Paul says here, literally, you wear something, you bring a reproach on your head. You bring about shame, and the shame comes by causing people to question or to be confused about you. And why would they be confused? Because of the associations with head coverings in this society, and also because the majority in the Corinthian society who are wearing head coverings are women. This would be equivalent to me this morning coming in wearing an Easter bonnet on my head or wearing a bow in my hair. There's some there. It's there. And you say, why is he wearing that? You see, Pastor Rudy's got a bow on. This guy's clearly confused. We're out of here. And I wouldn't blame you for that. You should leave. If I'm wearing a bow, you should leave. But there's certain dress, that you associate with men, with women. In Corinth, it was a veil. And so Paul uses this truth to drive home the spiritual principle. Not wearing a veil would be a physical representation, something that we could look at, something that we can clearly see, your distinction as a Christian man in Corinth and your position of authority that God has given to you. Now for women, verses 5 and 6, but every woman who prays or prophesies with her head uncovered dishonors her head, since it is the same as if her head were shaven. For if a woman will not cover her head, then she should cut her hair short. But since it is disgraceful for a woman to cut off her hair or shave her head, let her cover her head. Now there are times in the public sphere and times in the church when a woman would be praying. And that is simply, as Pastor John MacArthur defines that, that's talking to God about people. Or a woman would be prophesying, that's talking to people about God. And so Paul says, if you're talking to God about people or talking to people about God, well, he instructs them here differently. He says, you should have something on your head, and they should wear that veil as a physical symbol of who they are, who they've been made to be, but also as this symbol of surrender to God's will and submission to his design. And the only women who would not have had a head covering on were either temple prostitutes. They let their hair hang down to be seen by those around them. They didn't want anything to block the view of others. There were women who were caught in adultery or in sin, and they would have had their heads shaven. There were also some women, like in our day, who out of protest or wanting to be liberated or just wanting to be seen as one of the guys would have thrown off their veil. And so what Paul's doing is he's taking this cultural practice that's in place in Corinth, and he's using it to reinforce the spiritual principle. And so to toss off the veil would have been disgraceful because believing women would be associating themselves with things that were not of the Lord, and they would have been misrepresenting themselves and their position before God around others. And so in wearing a veil, they're distinguishing themselves as the men were from their old way of life, and they're distinguishing themselves as followers of the Lord God. Now remember, Paul put this practice in place because of that overarching principle of distinction in our roles. Again, veils are not the main thing. Veils, no veils, they don't make you any more or any less spiritual. He's just simply using a cultural practice as a picture of verse 3. Verse 10, Paul says, that is why. And so since this principle was put in place at creation, since there's already something in place that you practice here, a woman ought to have a symbol of authority on her head because of the angels. Okay. Well, first, what I want you to see clearly is that Paul is saying what about the head covering? It's just a symbol. But then he says something peculiar here. He says it's not just for yourselves, but it's also because of the angels. What in the world do the angels have to do with this? Well, if you think about it, the angels were there at creation. They witnessed God's intention and his design in creating men and women. They knew God's desire, and they longed to see the Lord put on display in and through his church. And also, if there's any being that is familiar with authority and submission, it's angels. If you look at Hebrews chapter 1, their sole purpose is submission to Christ. And so as angels care for believers, as angels watch over us, and the Bible is clear that they are among us, they should see our trust in God's design. They should see our obedience to his will. And so our reflection of God's glory and bringing God glory is for all of creation, literally in heaven and on earth. And Paul asks a question in verse 13. He says, judge for yourselves, is it proper for a woman to pray to God with her head uncovered? Considering the representations in society, considering the practice that was already in place in Corinth, considering the principle of distinction, Paul wants them to see why he's leading them in this way. Verses 14 and 15, here is where we go beyond culture to what is natural, to what is instinctual. Paul writes, does not nature itself teach you that if a man wears long hair, it is a disgrace for him, but if a woman has long hair, it is her glory, for her hair is given to her for a covering. Naturally, we have a symbol of distinction in our hair. Again, some more than others. Now, the veil today doesn't have any cultural significance, but there is style, there is dress, there are types of hair that do express distinction between men and women, male and female. And here's where I see the universal teaching. It's not necessarily in the veil, but it is what is natural and what is instinctual. Men should seek to look like men, and women should seek to look like women. Why? Because this is a way that we can point ourselves to the Creator. This is a way that we can point ourselves and others to this truth that there's distinction within us and within our relationships. Does this mean that women can't have short hair? I don't think it means that. There are certainly hairstyles that express womanhood. But if you're a guy, does that mean you can't have long hair? Well, you got to go before the Lord and seek Him. But what is your attitude behind that? Is it rebellion? Is it contentiousness? And I think Paul finishes this way with that, with us examining ourselves. He says in verse 16, Paul finishes, if anyone is inclined to be contentious, we have no such practice, nor do the churches of God. If anyone wants to rail against this, if anyone wants to rebel or oppose this, you're not going to find a church of God holding to the teaching of the Lord that has been passed down by the apostles where these principles are not lifted up. Ultimately, this is about pointing to Jesus, who created us distinctly male and female with the roles of authority and submission on purpose for his purpose for him. I'm going to invite our praise team forward. Like I said, you're going to have to seek the Lord in what this means specifically for you, both in your role, but also in your representation. But that brings us back to that question in the beginning. Here's what the Lord has for us. And so will we receive this? Will you surrender yourself and worship to him? Let's stand together. Let's sing this song. But more than sing it, let's let it be a prayer from our hearts to the Lord, to his glory.
Take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to thee. Take my moments and my days, let them flow in ceaseless praise. Take my hands and let them move at the impulse of thy love. Take my feet and let them be swift and beautiful for thee. Take my voice and let me sing always only for my King. Take my lips and let them be filled with messages from thee. Take my silver and my gold, not a mite would I withhold. Take my intellect and use every power as you choose. Here am I. Take my will and make it thine. It shall be no longer mine. Take my heart, it is thine own. It shall be thy royal throne. Take my love, my Lord, I pour. At your feet its treasure store. Take myself and I will be ever only all for thee. Here am I. It's all for thee.
It's all for thee.
Here am I.
Here am I.
All of me.
All of me.
Take my life.
Take my life.
It's all for thee.
It's all for thee.
Take my life.
Take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to thee. Take my moments and my days, let them flow. flow in ceaseless praise.
Amen. Well, as you follow up this week with your families, your friends, your small groups, we have several questions on the website that you can check out. I won't read all this word for word, but there's a couple passages that Pastor Rudy encouraged us to look up and ask this question. Am I receiving what the Lord Jesus has for me, or am I in some way fighting against this truth? So we have that and several other questions on the website. I'd love to remind you of the new reading plans that start for this week. You can jump into the reading plan at any point. Those are out by the main exit, and I'll be out there as soon as the service is over. If you have any questions about that, thanks for joining us this morning. You're dismissed.